celebrated my 90th birthday a few weeks ago. Allowing me to sit and talk. I'd like to say that I don't think of myself as 90. I think of myself as a 60-year-old trapped in a 90-year-old body. In 1999, North Korea launched a long-range missile. It happened to be an unsuccessful test. But the fact that they were testing it caused great concern that they may be cheating on this agreed framework which they made in 1994, because an ICBM doesn't make much sense unless you have a nuclear weapon on it. Doesn't make much sense anyway. But that led people to believe that in Congress and in the Diet, we ought to pull out of the agreed framework. And in that turmoil, President Clinton asked me if I would, I'm back at Stanford at the time, if I would temporarily come back into government and serve as his special representative on dealing with North Korea. And I foolishly accepted that assignment. First thing I did was I briefed Congress on what I was up to. Not all of them thrilled about that, but they seemed to accept it. I then asked the Japan Prime Minister and the South Korean President to appoint an equivalent person to work with me. So it was going to be a tripartite process rather than an American process. And the three of us spent the next couple of months working on the problem and came out with a report. The report basically laid out a diplomatic path, I would say coercive diplomatic, but diplomatic path for approaching North Korea. I think the most important single statement in that report was that we must deal with North Korea as it is and not as we would wish it to be. And I believe that statement is true today as it was in 1999. And so with that report, I requested a meeting with a North Korean leader, and they granted it. They allowed me to fly an Air Force plane directly into Pyongyang, which is very unusual. So unusual that we flew into North Korea. I was looking down, wondering whether the air defense people on the ground had gotten the word. And it was all right, Air Force plane to fly in there. It turned out to be a very interesting 4 days in Pyongyang, and we ended with a verbal agreement, which was quite comprehensive, both in terms of what North Koreans would not do, and in terms of what we would do to provide additional security assurances to them, and what Japan and South Korea would do in the way of economic incentives. This was followed by a series of actions in North Korea, some of which were quite encouraging, including allowing the North Korean athletes to march with the South Korean athletes in the Olympics, which was a symbolic gesture. It was very nice, I thought, symbolic gesture. Then Kim Jong-il sent his top military aide, Marshal Rowe, back to the United States to see if we could come to final agreement on what we had sort of a handshake agreement on. And he asked me if he would stop at Stanford on the way to meet with me so that I could show him around Silicon Valley, which I did, and arranged to take him to companies where the CEOs of the companies happened to be Korean Americans, so they could speak to him in his own language. They had a dinner for him at Stanford, again, where the members of Korean who speak to him in his own language. His meeting in Washington was successful. He met with both the Secretary of State and the President, and we were really having a final agreement then, but it wasn't yet signed. And that sign was normally set for a month or two in the future, whenever Clinton and Kim Jong-un wanted to get the schedule worked out. That happened in October of 2000, and a funny thing happened the next month called an election. And the new administration, which was elected then, initially was saying they were going to go along and continue that effort. But in fact, 2 months later, the President cut off all discussions with North Korea. And for 2 years, there were no discussions at all, and the whole process collapsed. The Bush administration believed they could get a better agreement. That may sound like familiar language. That was basically your approach. We're going to get a better agreement. That better agreement by 2017 had resulted in North Korea having 20 to 30 nuclear weapons, a few of them thermonuclear. repair a couple of hundred ballistic missiles, most of them capable of reaching South Korea, and some of them capable of reaching Japan, and working on missiles capable of reaching the United States. The purpose of these nuclear weapons, in my considered judgment, is to deter the United States from making a military attack on North Korea. That is their purpose, I think. They want to sustain the regime. They want to sustain more broadly the Kim dynasty. We should, it's hard for us to think in terms of dynasty, but that's what it is. And the leader, each of the three leaders of North Korea in its history, are essentially emperors with absolute power, including power to just summarily execute someone if they decide to do it. And certainly absolute power over the international decisions they make. This regime, in my judgment, is ruthless, including their own people, and it's reckless. But I do not believe they are suicidal. I do not believe they are crazy. This is not a leadership that's seeking martyrdom. It's not Al-Qaeda. It's not ISIL. They're seeking to keep in power. And therefore, in my judgment, they will use the nuclear weapons only in response to an attack. Put another way, the nuclear weapons are useful to them, but only if they do not use them. Once they use them, the leaders, they believe, understand that they're going to die and the country will be devastated. So the fear of an unprovoked attack, I think, is groundless. But still, it's a very dangerous situation, a very dangerous situation. If they use them, that is, if they are attacked, and there's certainly been ample talk in the United States of making a preemptive attack on North Korea, or even if they believe they're about to be attacked, they might use the nuclear weapons in that case. If they are attacked, they will use the nuclear weapons. And just pause for a moment to discuss the consequences of that. They have Seoul and Tokyo and other cities within range of their nuclear weapons. If they attack those cities, they will destroy them. We're talking about millions of people dying. This is not hyperbole, this is just what will happen if this goes on. I want to say also quite clearly, putting on my technical hat, not only former Secretary of Defense, but former Under Secretary for Research and Engineering, that we can avenge that action, but we cannot defend against a missile attack against Tokyo and Seoul. We should understand that very clearly. Because I believe that, I believe that our policy should be to ensure that that does not happen. How do we do that? And the first thing is, I believe that we have to get serious, really serious about diplomacy. I'm not going to have time in my brief discussion today to talk about how to do the diplomacy, but I'm convinced that there is a diplomatic path available to us. And I also believe, though, that the path to Pyongyang is through Beijing. I think it's the first start of diplomacy with China. So the U.S. and China can agree on what the dangers are and how we can deal with that danger and how we can deal with China's concern of having American troops along the Yellow River. This is one of the big things that I think holding them back can take meaningful action. So it's a serious problem, a real danger. What can Congress do about that danger? You heard a senator in the conference the other day talking about the bill that he had to legislation. This is by no means the total answer. It is an important first step. What can we do? What can you do about it? I think what the two companies described to you today, I cannot say it any better than that. Get behind those two particular pieces of legislation. It's not the whole answer. It's not a completely satisfactory answer. It's something concrete and something you can do. Whether or not those two bills ever pass, which is doubtful at the moment, it could change. But whether or not they ever pass, they are putting a spotlight on a very important issue. So I urge you all to get behind, as a single most important thing you can do, get behind those two bills and try to get attention to them. You got lots of attention to them, and maybe you can get them passed in the Congress. Thank you.